we have come to this morning. We're so glad that you're able to come and be in worship with us this morning. The ushers are coming to pass out the sign-in tablets. Take just a few moments to register your attendance with us. And if any of your Bible information has changed, telephone number, address, anything, go ahead and update that on those papers so that if we ever needed to get in touch with you, we could. Opportunities for this week. Coming up on Wednesday, September the 5th, we have Family Night Supper, which starts at 6 o'clock. And Mr. Jerry Hanley is going to come up and tell us what we're going to have for supper.
This week we're going to have Italian like we did last week, but this week we're going to have baked spaghetti and fettuccine alfredo and garlic toast salad and dessert. And I would like to take this opportunity also to thank all our cooks. They've done a wonderful job this year. And let's give them a hand. And if you haven't been to supper on Wednesday night or Wednesday night service, you need to come back because you're missing a true blessing.
I feel like Grandpa Jones, what's for supper? Followed it. So we got supper at 6. At 6:30, upper room prayer meets in JR's office, and they go over all of the prayer requests that have come in through that week. And then at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary, JR's continuing his sermon series on awesome news about grace. And this week is part 2, Guilt and Grace. So come and be a part of that. And then coming up next Sunday is Back to Church Sunday. Now, summer vacation is over, and it's time to fill in some of these empty spaces that I see here this morning. If you look in the pocket in the front of you in these pews, there's an I Miss You card. You can fill out an I Miss You card and invite somebody and tell them about Back to Church Sunday next week. Or better yet, call them up on the telephone and say, hey, we missed you, and come back and see us. Coming up on October the 21st is our congregational meeting, and we have 3 board positions that are coming open. And so we need to fill those. Applications will be available in the foyer. They need to be turned in to Ms. Gwen Bowen, our administrative assistant, and by October the 3rd, if you would like to be considered for nomination to the board here at Covenant. Blessings of hope, the rainbow of hope this week, we have pledged by all of y'all, 8,864.52. Your pledges and your contributions go to our ministries that not only help people here in Birmingham, but also all over the world. And so we want to take a moment to say thank you. JR wanted to also say Happy Labor Day to everybody and wish everybody your many blessings. He is gone to his family reunion this weekend, so you're stuck with me. I'm so sorry. But we do want to, on behalf of him and the staff and all of the board, we do want to wish you a Happy Labor Day. The Joymakers Ministry is meeting Tuesday, September the 4th at 6:30 in Danko Hall. Come and bring your favorite snack dish to share with everybody and have some fun with the Joymakers. They're always up to something. Next week, not only is it Back to Church Sunday, but the children also go back to church. They're back to children's church. I made this announcement when they were letting out, now I'm making it when they're coming back. You can't do that. But the covenant kids will start back up next Sunday at 10. The Lighthouse is meeting every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock in the Danko Hall in the back classroom. And on a sermon, on a lesson series, be quiet, don't mess me up. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Anyway, meaning of your name with a Bible verse. So that should be very interesting. Come and see what they have to teach you in Bible study. Also, on October the 5th, 6th, and 7th is Excel. Can you hear?
I'm here. Right here.
Excel. Excel's coming up. And Excel is basically a spiritual retreat It's like going to church camp. And if as a kid you went to church camp and had a good time, you would have a good time coming and going to church camp again. And that is October 5th, 6th, and 7th. It is a spiritual retreat. You're just worshiping God all weekend. And God has good things in store for people that come. He never lets us down. He's always there present. So if you would like to join us, it starts on Friday night at 7 o'clock and goes through to Sunday about 2:30. So we would love to have you. There is applications out in the foyer. And if you have been before and want to come back as a friend, please do. There are friend applications out in the foyer also. So if you have any questions, you'll see several rainbow stones on people around. Please come and ask your questions, and we would love to have you there. Thank you. Also, you want me to...
If you want to, that's fine.
Inquirer's class is a class where you come and find out what the foundational beliefs of Covenant is and be a part of the group if you're considering just joining the church, or if you just want to know, what do we believe? What do we believe? So we would invite you to come to that class. It is Saturday, September the 8th, and we start at 10 o'clock. We will give you a light lunch, pizza. We took all the calories out of it, and donuts for breakfast. So, I mean, what more could you ask for? Donuts and pizza and good conversation. So come join us. We would love to have you. We'll be in the fellowship hall in the back. Thank you.
Mary brought up a prayer bear that I missed this morning. It's for Teresa, a friend of John Siegel's, who's having knee surgery. So we're going to pass this around. If you would just take a few moments and pray over it, and then we give this prayer bear to her. And something she can have in the hospital and hold on to, and remember that there are those of us out there who are still praying for her. So Mary, if you'll start that for us. All right. Cindy Wiley's putting together a cookbook. Now, we got the sample just how good you all can cook last weekend. So, now that you already know where the recipes are, you can just go ahead and send them to Cindy Wiley, and her address is listed there so that you can get your recipes into the Covenant Cookbook. Upper Room Praise Reports this week. John Street is not only in church this morning, but he does not have to have surgery. And Covenant and myself was very, very blessed last weekend by an excellent camp meeting that we had. And so we just want to take a moment and thank God for that. Our board member on duty today is Ms. Bobby Causey. And our assistant board member is Mr. Will Johnson. Our deacon on staff is Ms. Shun Reddick. If you have any needs, please see one of them. Wednesday night supper, it's just one more time to remind you we'd like to eat around here. 6 o'clock, cost of the meal is $5, and the fellowship is priceless. Maybe if I get all of these out now, a little bit later when I'm standing down there, they won't be coming. Covenant birthdays this week. Lynn Lominick's on the 2nd. Is that today? Yeah, that's today. Judy Hand Truitt is on the 3rd, and Loretta Hinton is on the 8th. And so we want to wish them all a happy birthday. We want to say a special thank you to Mary Jones and Bobby Causey for preparing last Wednesday night's supper. I heard it was absolutely delicious. And we also want to... Oh, Lord, they done misbehaving just because JR's not here. And I'm just fixing to say thank you to Mary Jones, too. But we really do. We want to say thank you to Mary Jones for all of her tireless efforts and the work that she does here at this church to make it clean. From the bottom of all of our hearts, Mary, we want to say thank you for all that you do. Are y'all ready to praise the Lord this morning? Let's stand on our feet and sing some praises to God this morning.
I hope you came expecting this morning. Let's start with our opening praise and worship. Let the rocks keep silent. Let's do that second verse one more time. In the book 'tis written.
In the book 'tis written, saved by grace, oh the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Sing the story of sin. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white robed angel sings a story, a sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven,
one of the most beautiful choruses we sing. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. Let's worship the Lord this morning.
Oh, I'm resisting.
Would you pray with me, please? Loving and wonderful God, I come to you this morning. God, I pray that as we sing praises to you, as we worship you this morning, God, that it is a sweet sound to your ear, God. God, I pray that you would touch our minds, touch our hearts this morning. Help us to receive the message that you have for us today, God. Thank you for bringing us together this morning. God, I pray that you would be with our pastor and his family as they grieve the loss of their loved one this morning. God, I pray that you would touch them and help them to know that you are there with them, God, that you care about what they're going through, God. God, I pray that you would be with Heath this morning as he brings forth the message, God. Touch him. Touch his lips, God, and help us to receive what you would have us to receive today, God. Be with us in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you turn and bring those around, please?
Praise reports. And each Wednesday night, Jamie, our makes a list, and they go over each one of these prayers individually and lift them up to the throne of grace. Maybe you didn't have a chance to list your prayer requests in the book this morning, or maybe it's so deeply personal that you and God are the only two that know. If you have a silent prayer request, raise your hand to God this morning. As we go to God, there's several things that I want us to remember this morning. Kate was telling me about going to visit Joe Griffin, who had surgery on Thursday. It's a Thursday or Friday, Kate. Had the surgery on Friday morning. He's in intensive care. And he needs a touch. From the ground of his head to the sole of his feet, he needs a touch, and he needs our prayer. Jeanette mentioned in her prayer, J.R.'s Aunt Annie passed away. She was the last of the four monarchs of their family at 110. And that's a lesson in itself, 110. But I know, even after 110 years, as much as you've lived, you still will be missed. We also remember Alan this morning. He's going to have surgery next week. And so we want to keep him in our thoughts and in our prayers. And Marjorie Gomez, who used to be the pastor of this church, she's having a lot of health issues. And we want to lift all of these people in our prayers. So as you've heard y'all say, from the cares that fret and the burdens that weary, let them all be laid aside as we go and approach the throne of grace. Loving God, we come to you this morning trusting in a faithful and loving God. God, your promise is to never leave nor forsake us. And so we're calling on that promise this morning. We're calling on that promise for Adam as he goes and has surgery. We're calling on that promise for Joe Griffin as he stays in an hospital bed. God, we pray that you're able and willing to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think. So we ask you this morning to touch him from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. Let him know in that hospital bed that your presence is there this morning. Lord, we ask that you be with our former pastor, Marge, as she goes through these troubling health times. God, you're able. You know our needs before we do. But we bring them to you because we trust in you. We bring them to you because we put our faith in you. And God, be with JR and his family as they suffer the loss. The loss of Aunt Annie. 110 years she blessed that family with her being here. But now that they need a touch of comfort from you so that they are allowed to go through this grieving process.
The presence.
you are able. For the reading is from the book of James, chapter 1, verses 19 through 26. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness of God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror, and after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You may be seated.
You shall wear.
sure have church this morning.
Amen.
I think I'm just going to throw him some hand. Hey, that's a good job. Thank y'all. LaWanna, Scotty, Clara, all of you. Thank you so much. One of these days, we're going to wear our crown. Until we get there, we got to get through this life we're in now. And so, here we are. We finally made it to Labor Day. Labor Day weekend. The point that typically marks the end of our summertime. The last time we go to the beach, or maybe go to the lake. Or maybe even for some of us, to wear parts of our wardrobe. Anybody got on any white shoes? Well, for others, it marks the great new beginnings. By now, the teachers and students alike have settled into their new school year. And I don't need to even mention what, well, technically got started Thursday, but really got the kickoff yesterday. I'm sorry, Alvin, I can't hit you. The mornings are starting to be a little cooler. The fall colors will be coming on shortly. Before you know it, Thanksgiving, Christmas, and New Year's will be right around the corner. And so as we come to what marks the end of the summer, and we're preparing for the transition into the fall, I want us to take a look this morning. A look at our spiritual maturity. Over the last 8 months, have we grown into or toward the person that God has called us to be? And offer a few helpful hints along the way. On a sermon call this morning, today, it's all about you. Let us pray. Let God, we thank you for an opportunity to come in your house and to worship. Lord, I ask that you touch these lips of clay, that they might be an open and willing vessel to the words that you should have us to hear this morning. And in the psalmist David said, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing unto you, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. If all this be in the name we pray, amen. Well, there were a couple of ladies who decided to go on a camping trip. Imagine that. See, well, they go up into the mountains, and they find them a nice little campground on a clearing spot with woods all around them. They pitch their tent and fall fast asleep. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Luana looks over and shakes Kay. And she says, look up toward the sky and tell me what you see. Kay looked up and she thought about it. She said, I see millions of stars shining brightly in the sky. Luana looked at it and said, well, what else do you see? And so Kay thought about it for a moment and she thought, well, astronomically speaking, there are millions of galaxies in the sky. Time-wise, it appears to be about 3:15 in the morning. Theologically, it appears that God is all-powerful. And sometimes we seem so small and so insignificant. Weather-wise, it looks like we're going to have a beautiful day tomorrow. Well, why, what do you see? She says, honey, you're all book sense and no common sense. Because if you see the sky, somebody stole the tent. I told you I was going to use you, didn't I? You see, Marquette's mind was busy laboring over the philosophy of Luana's question. She missed what was right there in front of her. But today in the scripture lesson from James, we're called to be a doer of the word and not just a hearer of it. And it's kind of ironic the fact that the lectionary scriptures were set long before there was ever a Labor Day where we celebrate not working, yet lesson is a call to action, or a call to labor, if you will. Over the last few Sundays, J.R. has presented us with some areas for both personal and spiritual growth, including how to deal with our frustrations and how to get along better and improve our relationships with others, and also how to use words to heal and not words to hurt. And I don't know if any of you noticed, there was something in the Times Plus this morning that I didn't cover, and it talks about ordinary time. And what ordinary time is, this is a time when we take lessons, J.R. and all of us who talk, we take lessons that instruct us on how to learn to live our Christian faith out in our daily lives. And so when you take and apply these everyday life lessons, they show us how to both grow and to mature spiritually. James talks about a person who looks in the mirror and looks at himself and then turns around and forgets what they see. So I want us to look in the mirror this morning. I want us to look and see if we're being a doer of the word and not just a hearer of it. To take these few simple steps and improve our walk with God and improve our relationships with others. You know, a lot of times you hear people say, and J.R. says it a lot, it's not all about you. Oh, it's not all about you. Well, guess what, folks? Today, it's all about you. It's all about you and your growth and your walk with God. And James just happens to give us a few pointers to help us along that way. The first one in James chapter 19, chapter 1, verse 19, he says, "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen." James starts right out here by saying that we've got to be quick to listen. And there's a reason why we have two of these and only one of these. Have you ever wondered why preachers, teachers, speakers, whenever they're trying to make a big point, they repeat themselves over and over? It's because the breakdown in communication comes not in what's being said, but in what's being heard. So often, I love Charlie Brown, and we have those Charlie Brown moments. Wah, 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 wah. We know somebody's saying something important. We know they're speaking, but something just gets crossed in our brain, and we cannot understand and comprehend what's being said. One of the reasons why we get so disconnected is because there's so much going on. Today's society is infested with busyness. There's no downtime built into our lives anymore. No quiet moments that we can collect our thoughts and even take a moment to see if God might be speaking to us. Paul Odom sings a song here that says, "He still speaks. I know his voice. Sweetest sounds ever heard by the word." To think that God, by his very own choice, would speak to me, it makes me rejoice. He still speaks. I know his voice. But what if we never stop to listen? To think that God, by his very own choice, would choose out of everybody else to speak to me. But if I'm too busy in my busyness, I would never hear it. A friend of mine, Marty Herrick, which some of you may remember, played the devil a few years ago in Easter program. He called me. Now, it had been a month. It probably been 4 or 5 months since I'd heard from him. He called, he said, "Do you know who this is?" I said, "No, not really." "You're going to have to tell me, baby." You see, I didn't have a clue who it was because I hadn't talked to him in so long. Now, I know, and I know you know, that God ranks a little higher on the total pole than Marty Harry, but the point remains the same. In our spiritual walk with God, we have got to be quick to listen. And not just to God, who's the most important, but what about listening to those around us? I'm going to ask you a question, and you might want to pick your feet up, some of you. When is the last time that you sat down and had a meal with somebody and left that phone in the other room? Or, if, that's true. Or, but you didn't pass on this next one. Or, sit down and have a meal with somebody not in front of the television. So that every few words every time somebody starts to speak, I want to hush, hush now. I'm trying to watch my stories. You see, there are times in our lives when what we need is our brothers and sisters in Christ. What we need is somebody who will listen to us without judgment, without critiquing what we have to say, but somebody to just let us talk out our problems. What we don't need is opposing thumbs moving at warp speed. Our channels changing. And one of the best examples of people being quick to listen is children. You know, little children are just like sponges. They soak up whatever you say. The downside is, they're not always really quick to speak. And it seems like at the most inopportune times, they'll spit back whatever they've heard you say. And generally, right in front of whoever you were talking about earlier. And so that brings me to point number two. James told us to be quick to listen, but he also told us to be slow to speak. In verse 26, he goes on to say, those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongue deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. In no way, shape, form, or fashion does James sugarcoat what he thinks the tongue can do. And if you think that passage is a little sharp, flip over to chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, and he says, likewise, the tongue is the small part of the body, but yet it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by just a small spark. That tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. To be such a small, seemingly insignificant part of the body, oh, what trouble it can give us in. It can either be also helpful or also hurtful. Even J.R. brought it up. 3 weeks ago, he brought up a sermon, how to use words to hurt instead of words to heal. So you might want to know, well, why are we talking about this again? Well, I guess you could just ask Moses why they had to wander around for 40 years when Canaan was so close. You see, even in public speaking, even as I'm standing here talking to this big group, that tongue can be just as sharp and just as belittling. If we were half as quick to quote scripture as we are to spit out those little one-liners and jabs, what a difference our lives would make. What a witness we would be if we were able to tame our tongue. James also goes on in verse 19 and 20, and he says to be slow to anger. Because in our anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. In order to truly become slow to anger, you need to figure out what's making you so angry. You got to figure out what it is, and what are the ways you can deal with it. And yes, even Jesus experienced anger. In Luke chapter 19, verses 45 and 46, he says, when Jesus entered the temple courts, he began to drive out those who were selling. For he said, it is written, In my house, there will be a house of prayer, but you've made it into a den of robbers. So yes, even Jesus experienced anger. It's not that you're never going to experience anger. It's like Paul said in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 6, in your anger, do not sin. You see, we all are going to experience anger from time to time. But it's what you choose to do with it. Do you choose to channel that anger and make a difference like Jesus did? Or do you just explode like a Coke can somebody shook up? You ever seen anybody walking around just ready, sitting on ready, just ready to pop off any minute? Now these are just a few examples of anger. But what about anger that comes from deep within? What about an anger from dreams that never come true? From relationships that never went the way you wanted them to? From hopes? Anger from heartache? What about that kind of anger? You see, that can be one of the most destructive types of anger there is. Because you bottle it up inside, and then it just eats away at you. Until you start lashing out at those closest to you. Because they're always going to love you. They're going to love you no matter what. Oh, they'll be alright. They'll forgive you. In your anger this morning, don't sin. And if you're holding on to anger that you can't seem to get rid of, let me tell you this one thing, and if you want to listen to anything else I say, listen to this. God is bigger than any of your anger.
Amen.
If you will let Him, if you will turn that over to God, let that anger go, you'll have more room for peace, more room for joy, and more room for hope in your life. Some people want to hold on to that anger because they feel like it's all they've got left. I'm here to tell you this morning, God is bigger than that anger.
Amen.
And He can take and fill that void far better than that anger can. And so finally, He said, therefore get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent. And humbly accept the word that's planted within you, which can save you. You see, when you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, a seed is planted within you. The seed of salvation, the seed of grace. But it's up to you to walk with God, and it's up to you to grow. The reality is life is very short, regardless of whether it's 10 years or 110 years like I am. And sometimes we have to make these split-second decisions that we have to live with for the rest of our lives. In those split-second decisions, are you being a doer of the word or just a new hearer of it? Are you putting into practice the things that you hear here on Sunday morning? Or do you just walk out the back doors of the church and forget everything you've heard? One of the best ways to learn how to lean on God is to accept His forgiveness, to accept His grace and His mercy in your life. There's one thing I want to tell you before I get on. And I found this week. My mother sent it to me. She knew what I was talking about. And it pretty much sums up everything that we've talked about this morning. It says, before you talk, listen. Because it might change what you say. Before you react, think. Because it might change how you react. Before you judge, wait. Because it might just change your viewpoint. And before you quit, try. Because it might be the very best thing that you've ever done.
Amen.
Paul said in Philippians chapter 3, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. This morning, are you pressing on toward the goal? While the title says it's all about you, and it is, it's all about you and your walk with God. Are you learning to be slower to speak and slower to anger? Are you learning to listen to those around you? God can help you with that. God can give you the power to change into the person that He has called you to be. If you let Him, would you stand and sing? Learning to live.
Every giver, each and every one, and I thank you for the gifts.
We ask all this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
All things have been made ready. Won't you come as the ushers direct?